These 10 players are off on an adventure, working together to pass a series of tests.
Each test they pass adds money to a group pot that only one player will win.
But one of the 10 players is a mole, a double agent, working for us to sabotage the group's efforts. Every few days, there's a quiz about the mole.
The player who scores the lowest on the quiz must leave the game immediately.
It is a simple game. Be observant, expose the mole, claim the money.
Previously on The Mole.
They basically talk to each other very, very frequently. I refer to them as the unholy trinity.
I just want to trust someone. I want to have that for a few minutes.
You're gonna have to convince the three other players to undertake three assignments, which are either very risky or appear very risky. It's worth an exemption.
The exemption puts it down to me in the finals with one other person.
I have full faith and confidence in my fellow law enforcement guy.
I gave my word to Jim.
Charlie.
He committed mole suicide for me.
Some of these young whiz kids have sharper minds than I do.
I'm humbled by you guys putting me lowest on your list.
Don't be too humbled by it, buddy.
10 strangers playing for up to $1 million. Among them, a saboteur, a traitor, the mole. The winner, the one who answers the question, who is the mole? Charlie was the last to go. A veteran cop, he played the game well, but not well enough. He was the mole's seventh victim. And then there were three cunning competitors who'd also become friends, or so they said. In this game, friendship can be a weapon the mole is not afraid to use.
Okay, good evening, America. I'm still here, believe it or not.
I guess people asking about me flirting with Catherine or something. Look, she's not my type. Short, dark-haired, pale-skinned, and, well, smarter than me, frankly.
It seems worth it. It seems worth it to be heading into the last few days with Jim and Steve, who are my closest friends here, even if maybe they'll turn out to not be true friends at all.
Just not sure. And that's the game. Never be sure, because if you're too sure, you are screwed. You're screwed.
In my kind of whole game theory, the mole is going to be more active at this stage in the game.
You're really pretty on camera.
It's Jim? Okay, who's the mole?
I'm the mole. Who's the mole?
What are you gonna do?
Wait, aren't you forgetting someone?
In a way, it's sort of weird since Charlie's been executed, because when there were other people around, I think it was probably less likely that we would turn on each other. But now that it is just the three of us, I think that the bonds are weakening. My theory is that Jim knows that Steve is the mole, and that their whole bosom buddy act has always been designed to keep me away from Steve.
When I paired up with Jim, I knew that there was a possibility that we could be facing each other at the end if we both had achieved the goal, and we did. And I think that in the end, that partnership will probably do me in.
If it turns out he's the mole, you know, I'm gonna see it with 20/20 hindsight, clear as day.
Will the coalition do one of them in? That question will soon be answered.
You're playing a good game if you're the mole.
27 days ago, there were 10. By forging a friendship that Charlie called the unholy trinity, these three have outlasted the rest.
I'm gonna lie down, sorry.
What?
I'm gonna lie down.
Okay. Are you really sitting back there because you want to lay down, or because you want to be as far away as possible?
I just want to lay down. I just want to be done. What?
We miss you.
Mm-hmm.
We do. We really do.
You guys are annoying and insulting. I'm just sick of it.
Oh, crap. I just think there's at least one person in this car who's getting completely played. Possibly two.
Could be. Whichever one of you turns out to be the mole, I don't envy the position to a large degree. Especially now that there are three of us and it's the three people who wanted to play together and now we're in this position. Here we are.
Just be careful what you wish for. You talk about it.
Yeah.
Hey guys, welcome. Come on up. Congratulations, you three have made it to the finals, as you know. I know all three of you wanted to be in the finals together, and you have gotten your wish. As you know, there's $490,000 so far in the group pot. Today, you'll have an opportunity to earn even more. It is time for another test. In the last couple weeks, you've all been watching each other very closely, all been obsessively taking notes on everything from what you have for breakfast in the morning to the color of your underwear, which doesn't take Sherlock Holmes to figure out the color of Jim's underwear on any given day. This next test will show whether or not all that note-taking has actually paid off. Now, you've already answered a series of questions about each other. As you know, some of the questions were embarrassing. Some of them, frankly, were downright offensive. This test will be based on those questions. This test will determine not only how well you know each other, but also what you think about each other. There are three rounds. In the first round, Stephen, you'll be taken to a house and isolated there. Jim and Catherine, it's up to you two to find him. In order to find the house, you'll have to answer three questions correctly. You do that, you'll figure out how to get to the house. Each round is worth $10,000. Three rounds, the most you can earn in this test is $30,000. All right, this is the first question. A deadly snake has bitten the other two players, and you only have anti-venom for one person.
Oh, this is terrible.
Would Steve give it to Catherine or to Jim? If you say it's Catherine, we'll go in that direction. If you think you'd give the venom to Jim, we'll go in that direction.
Every answer is critical. If they miss just one, they'll never find Steven.
I'm thinking he's going to give it to you because I will say, don't give it to me, give it to her. So then he will decide, okay, we'll give it to Catherine. That's my vote.
I think he just likes me better.
That's good enough.
I'm kidding. No, that's I think good. You would just say it because I'm the girl.
Yeah, well, that's another way to put it. We say he would give it to Catherine, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. So we'll go this way.
Oh, so we don't even get to know.
We don't even know if we got it right.
Time for your next question. Who would you not trust with your most valued secret? If he said Catherine, we'll go up in that direction. If he wouldn't trust Jim, we'll go in that direction.
Okay, work this out. All you do is tell stories, and you mention the people by name constantly in these stories. I vote that we do it for you. That he would trust you less than me. He would not trust you.
Okay.
That he would trust me.
Yeah, that's probably right.
Then we'll go in this direction.
Only two doors remain. With this next question, we'll see if the players have chosen the correct path.
All right, this is the last and final question in the first round. Who is more likely to lie to your face for something of significant value, Catherine or Jim? If you say Catherine, it's this door.
Well, Catherine. It's me, obviously.
Yeah, well, I actually would have chosen Catherine over that, too.
Thanks.
No, not because I think that's the case, but I think that's what he would choose to answer on the question.
Okay,
clearly. So you're saying he would lie, you would lie.
I will lie and I cannot keep secrets. Open the door.
Okay, it's for you to knock on the door if you think Steve is in there.
Hola.
Hola.
Bueno, ya. ¿Dónde es Steve?
Come on.
Steve?
I'm afraid
no comprendo.
You're wrong.
Sadly, Catherine and Jim failed to find Steven. They answered one of the questions incorrectly and went down the wrong path.
As you may have guessed, they knocked on the wrong door. So, you lost the first round, you didn't get the $10,000. And why don't you tell them how you answered these questions? The first question was, you only have anti-venom for one person. Who did you decide to give it to?
That would be Jim.
Actually, that is incorrect.
No?
No.
It turns out, Steven paid no attention to his own answers.
On the list, I went Jim, Catherine, all the way down the list, back and forth.
You answered completely randomly.
Right.
So Steve's random answers cost you all $10,000.
Right. If you know that people are going to be trying to guess your answers, the only way you could guarantee they would get it wrong is to do it randomly. Do we have to do this right this second?
We don't have to do anything.
No.
Hey, let's walk this way. Let's go. Let's go over here. Okay, first question that Catherine has answered. Who's more likely to sneak a peek at his birthday present, Steve or Jim?
Does she think you're that sneaky?
I don't know. She's saying I'm the...
Let's go with you.
Okay, let's go with me.
Let's go with him.
Yeah?
Okay. Yeah.
So that means we go this way, Steve. Come on. The second question. Who is less likely to pick up a tab in a restaurant, Steve or Jim? If the answer is Jim, go up in that direction. If it's Steve, that direction.
Can't wait. There's got to be a rationale why she would choose one of us.
Well, wait a second. We had that conversation yesterday.
That's what I was thinking about, that conversation.
Yeah.
All right, we'll go with me.
Jim?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah? Yeah, sure.
This direction. Okay, so this is the last and final question. If you get this right, and Catherine is behind one of the doors, you'll get $10,000. The question is, it is Catherine's last day on Earth. Who would she rather not spend the day with?
Well, from a purely sexual point of view, last day on Earth, you want to kind of go out with a bang. It ain't going to be me. Well, look at the permutations.
Yeah, but
here.
I'm
funny.
Yes, I mean, that's exactly what I was going to say.
Do you value sex?
Or humor.
Straight sex or humor.
The age-old debate, isn't it? Steve, I do believe you're blushing.
You're making me blush here, man.
Well, if I were straight, it would clearly be me.
Yes,
I mean, there's no question about
yes.
that.
All right, then go.
She would least want to spend it with me, so.
Yeah. All right, why don't you go knock on that door? If Catherine's behind it, you get $10,000.
Hola.
Oh, baby. We got 500 now, right?
Yeah, we do.
Right. Let's go for 510.
So, Catherine, do you want to explain your last answer? Your last day on Earth?
I think they did a great job. I heard the whole discussion. We'll just, I don't think I will explain it. I'll let you guys think whatever you want to think.
With the pot at $500,000, Stephen and Catherine now must figure out how Jim's mind works.
If you could be either person for one day only, whom would you choose? If you think the answer is Catherine, we'll go down that way. If you think the answer is Steve, we'll go up this road.
I'm gonna guess he would say me. Just based on the fact that we've had lots of conversations about him being gay, and he told me he'd never want to be a woman. So, there you go.
Okay.
All right, that means we go this way.
Yep.
Second question. Who would have fewer people attend his or her funeral, Catherine or Steve?
Me, probably.
I was gonna say me.
It's me.
Why would it be you?
Because Jim puts all good things for you and all bad things for me, so it's me.
No, he doesn't.
Yes, he does. That's the strategy, I'm sure of it.
I think he'd probably put me.
Well, okay. Well, we can go that way if you want.
Go ahead, make a decision. Okay, yeah. Let's go that way.
All right, Captain, this way.
That's a hideous question.
This is the final question. Who is more likely to cheat on their significant other?
Well, I'm not going to say me on this one.
I'm not going to say me.
Well, let's phrase it this way. Who's Jim going to say is more likely to cheat? This does not mean it is an accurate reflection. It is simply what Jim put as the answer.
I'm going to say Jim would say me.
He'd probably say me.
I already say you need to think.
Again, all bad things are for me, all good things are for you. This is a hideous game.
So I guess we have to determine, do you think he's using a strategy or not?
I think Jim always uses a strategy, but I don't know that that's necessarily why I get all the bad things.
Let's say he is using a strategy, and you're correct on what it is.
So up here?
Mm-hmm.
That's your answer. All right, Catherine, go through the gate. It's the door on your left. It's the brown door.
great. I was right. It's Jim. We won $10,000.
Did we win?
Yes, we did.
What's wrong?
Nothing.
Are you going to get all mad about something and answer something stupid, ridiculous test now?
Where no, you have let's to choose go. We're done. We won. Let's go.
He is already married. She hasn't taken her vows yet, so I chose her. Simply based on that. Isn't that logical?
Yes.
No. Might as well have taken vows.
Each of these, you have to think of one logical hook, whether it's who would you rather have sex with on your last day? He's already married, you're not. Not because I think you would cheat and he wouldn't, or vice versa, it's simply that. And you got it, we won, 10,000. What's wrong?
Nothing, it's all good.
Apparently not.
Well, I thought it was just silly to let the game get to you because the game is designed to get to you. So the first thing that you should do is not let the game get to you.
You guys won two rounds of the game.
Do we have to do this right this second?
We don't have to do anything. No. Let's walk this way. Let's go. Let's go over here.
That was just terrible.
She thought you would say all good things go to Steve, all bad things go to Catherine. Which I'm sure wasn't.
No.
Yeah. You want me to go there? Or you want me to just wait here?
Do I think you would cheat on your spouse? On Brad? Do I think that? Not for one second. But I had to choose one. I sat there answering those questions saying, you know, how do I choose? How do I choose one?
It's okay. It's okay.
And it's not okay because it's not okay because look at you. You're going to make me cry. It's not okay. It's not okay.
It's just a horrible test.
It is a horrible test. But you can't let that get under your skin.
This victory came at a price, and for the players, the day is far from over.
Jim is in a completely blacked out room.
She's just in there in the dark?
Okay, wait, the lights just came on. Hold on.
I hated the three-question test. I didn't like answering the questions myself or other people, and obviously I got upset when I heard some of their answers.
I think she feels that Jim and I are teaming up or pairing against her, and truly we're not.
People have different triggers, and I don't think that she was having a good day to begin with.
Buenas tardes, señor.
The remaining three players believe they're simply checking into yet another hotel. But this is the location of their last test, their final chance to add $75,000 to the pot. What they don't realize is that once inside their separated rooms, they will be locked in. They'll need the help of the others to get out. Rest will have to wait. The final test has begun. The test is simple. The players have 90 minutes to get out of their locked rooms and meet me back downstairs in the lobby as a group. In each room, there are clues that will help the other players to escape from their rooms. For example, Catherine has clues that will help Jim and Steven escape. To share the clues, they all must find a way to communicate. Catherine's room has a television set, two video cassettes, the movie Psycho and the movie Scream.
Jim!
Binoculars, a key, and attached to a cable, a stationary bike. In Steven's room, the most obvious clue is the laptop computer. There's also a briefcase and a refrigerator, both with chains and combination locks. Jim is in the dark. Literally. There's no light in his room, but with this special night vision camera, we can see his every move.
Hello? Can anyone hear me?
Thank you.
cool.
No, can I have more?
While the search for clues continues, Jim gropes his way to the phone and tries to contact hotel reception. There's one problem. At this hotel, no one speaks English.
This is reception. Reception?
Sí, esto es recepción, dígame.
Usted recepción, ¿sí?
Sí, está usted hablando con recepción.
Stephen Coles.
¿Cómo? ¿Steven?
Stephen Coles. C-O-L-L. Yes.
Hey, hello.
Yo, it's Jim.
Okay, how'd you get my number?
I called reception.
Okay.
And I don't know how I called reception, but I did. I got through in my ridiculously stupid French, Spanish, English, Franglish. Your room number is 106. Do you have a light in your room?
Yeah, I do. Do you?
Recepción, dígame.
Jim Morrison, por favor.
¿Cómo?
Room for Jim Morrison.
There's all kinds of stuff written all over the walls when the black light comes on. But it's only on for like a couple seconds. It's pretty cool.
Es que no hablo inglés, solo español, ¿eh?
My room is completely lit. Okay, so in my room, I have, my door is,
Keypad, right? With a
keypad.
Flashing red light.
Right. I have a small refrigerator that's chained shut.
106. Gracias.
When I try to turn on the computer, it won't stay on. Yeah, so like, I'm guessing it's a power thing.
I
mean, it'll initially come on and then...
Uh-huh. You don't even know. Oh, wait.
Hold on, the light just came on. All I can read is one Carlos.
I'll tell you what, let me try 0106, and then we'll try and figure out how to get Catherine and get her room number.
Okay. Bye bye.
¿Cómo se dice teléfono Catherine Price?
Hello?
What are you doing?
I've kind of been trying to call you. Are you guys talking to each other?
Yeah, we're talking to you. Well, every time I'm trying to get a hold of you, it's been busy.
I've been trying to call you. Okay.
I am in a room right now. It's got a suitcase, a laptop, and a refrigerator.
Suitcase, laptop, fridge. Okay, I was just looking in the shower because of this whole psycho thing, so I bet I haven't found anything in there.
Jim is in a completely blacked out room.
He's just in there in the dark?
Yeah, now tell me about your stationary bike real quick.
I've ridden it a couple of times, just like randomly.
Okay, what I want you to do is get on that bike and stay on that bike for a few moments, okay?
Hey, you just talked to Catherine, huh?
Are your lights coming on and staying
on? No, they're not. Why? Okay, wait, the lights just came on. Hold on. It says find one. One Guerrero, G-U-E-R-R-E-R-O.
Write this down, man. The lights are going to go off.
Okay.
Juan Valdez.
Okay, hang on real quick. Okay. Hey, listen, okay? Catherine is controlling your lights. So
my lights are staying on.
I know,
on
they're going to be on for about 90 seconds, okay? It's because she's on the bike. Okay, just relax. I'll be right back with you in about 1 minute, okay?
Bye-bye.
Hello?
Okay, you're controlling Jim's lights on the bike. This is what I'm gonna need you to do for a few minutes, okay? I'm gonna need you just do a slow pace on that bike, okay? I'm gonna call Jim back, he's giving me some names. And we're gonna try and go ahead and figure out from there, okay?
Just call me back when he's gotten everything written down. Okay, bye.
Okay, Trust no one. Kate, number six. Steven is the mole. Jim is the mole. You have the key. That's interesting.
You have the key. Okay. Catherine has a big key in her room.
She does.
Okay. Anyways, what else is on the wall?
Okay. You are number eight. Wendy, number three. Offie, number two. Charlie, number seven. Just, you know, a lot of stuff. Well, it says
you are number eight. It's whatever.
Okay. Find one, and it's got Juan Guerrero. G-U-E-R-R-E-R-O.
G-U-E.
R-R-E-R-O.
Hang up, you guys.
It's something to do with the three names. Juan Guerrero, Juan Carlos, and Juan Valdez. That cultural guide that has nothing to do, you can't find anything in that.
Here's a one, director Juan Carlos, hang on.
The thing is, Juan Carlos is a fairly common, popular name. Well, look for anything that has to do with Juan Guerrero or Juan Carlos. I mean, are there any numbers?
The date is 19th of October.
Okay, so that's 10-19.
I guess, yeah, 10-19, yeah.
Both Catherine and Steven have found the same number, but she can't get through on the phone, so she continues her search. In a drawer, she finds a book and translates the title, A Room with a View. The first major clue has been found.
Nice to have my lights on, but whatever, she's working on something fine.
Hang up.
9:22:00, the day all the players met for the first time in the Mojave Desert. Catherine's out. Will there be time to free the others?
Play the music on your xylophone.
Oh my God, I have to play this whole thing? You're gonna have to give me some light for a little while.
It's okay, I'm out.
Okay, you're out?
Go try it on your door right now.
Okay, hold on.
Steven tries the same number Catherine just used.
Nope.
It doesn't work on your door?
No, I'll try it.
Does Jim have a combo thing also?
Yeah, he does too. He can't see anything though unless you're in your room on the bike. Okay, so why not, if you get on the bike, I'll call him real quick and tell him to try these numbers.
Yeah.
Okay, Jim?
Yeah.
Okay. She has her door unlocked.
She does?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
How'd she get it?
She saw on a van very far away the date, our start date, which is 0922. Mm-hmm. Okay. She tried that, I guess, and it worked.
Okay, so okay. What do you want me to try?
10-19.
I tried
because
that.
Because she had 10-19 also on her shower curtain.
Okay, or 0922.
Yep.
You want me to hang up or you want to stay on?
Go ahead. I'm hanging on.
Okay. All right, none of those work. Just if I entered 0922, nothing happened.
Okay.
Yeah.
You out of breath yet?
A little bit.
Okay. 1019 and 0922 don't work.
The 1019 has to work on something. They wouldn't just have a random.
Well, yeah, I know. I want you to come to my room real quick, and we'll see if we can coordinate something through the door. Hola.
Hey.
Hey.
My key does not do anything to that.
It does not?
No. Is there anything else in your room with a lock on it?
The suitcase, which is unlocked. Okay. And in that was a sickle, a hand mirror, some sunglasses, a newspaper, and this guide that I'm looking at.
Do you have a safe in your room? I had a safe in my room.
Yeah, I do. Was there anything in yours?
No, I never got it open.
No. Miami, I don't think there's anything in there.
Try the 1019 or the 922 on the safe.
Okay, hold on. Hey, Catherine?
Yeah?
Okay, it opened.
What's in there?
A little statue figurine of, it looks like the Virgin Mary.
Statue of Virgin Mary?
Yeah, a little figurine.
Okay. In the suitcase, you had newspaper, a cultural agenda.
Yeah, you want to see it? Here it is. Do you have a safe in your room, can you see?
Hey, Steve?
Yeah?
I found something.
Okay, hold on.
I found music.
Okay, go ahead.
In the, here, you can look at it.
Where is that?
Inside the newspaper.
Oh, inside the newspaper.
It's gotta be for the xylophone.
That's true, only I can't read music.
I can't read music either.
Do you wanna shove this piece of paper under Jim's door? Hey, Jim, can you read music?
Barely.
Jim?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay, I'm shoving this under your door.
Okay.
Play the music on your xylophone. Can you do that?
You know, I don't really read music that well.
Oh, you don't?
Oh my God, I have to play this whole thing? You're gonna have to give me some light for a little while.
Okay. I'll go give you a couple minutes of light. We only have like 7 minutes left.
All right, go give me some light. Yeah.
How are you doing?
Okay, number one. Yeah, I can read these basic
notes. I can tell you what a C is, and I can tell you what a D and an E and an F and all that kind
of thing. But you can't find it on the xylophone?
But I don't know where to begin on the xylophone because, you know, I'm halfway to tone deaf, so, I mean, I'm not going to figure out which one's a C, so I'm not going to be able to do it.
Okay, you have the best Spanish. Could you call downstairs and try to see, like, if they can even say who Juan Guerrero is?
Unless there's someone in the hotel with that name that I could call, but...
Right, maybe that's what I mean. Like, maybe
that's someone we need to, like, reach.
Juan Carlos.
Showing off his vast knowledge, Jim has just asked for Juan Carlos, the king of Spain.
Okay, Steve?
Yeah?
Have you found anything in there?
Nope.
Nothing with the laptop?
Nope. Well, I can't get it to stay on enough.
You can't get it to stay on?
There's no power. Well, we got about 90 seconds.
Right.
Less than that. Hang on. Hello.
Yeah, we're almost out of time, aren't we?
Yeah, we got less than a minute.
What are we missing?
What is escaping me here?
Same thing that's escaping me, buddy.
Hey.
Sorry. You did a great job.
Thanks.
All right. We still need to get Steve and Jim out of the room, so let me show you how the test would have worked.
Okay.
All right? First, we need to find the one Juan you were looking for.
Okay.
Come this way. Hola.
At the front desk was a package reserved under Juan Guerrero's name. That's the name of one of the receptionists, and perhaps the easiest of clues. All Catherine needed was to come to the front desk and ask for him. Inside the package were several smaller packages. The smallest held a wooden box. The mysterious key found in Catherine's room unlocked this small box, and inside it was the key to Stephen's room.
You'll notice four markings on four keys.
Mm-hmm.
1570.
Mm-hmm. Zero.
The first clue in Stephen's room was his laptop. On the keyboard, at the edge of keys 0, 7, 5, and 1, were small white marks. These numbers opened the lock on his refrigerator door, and inside was the mask of a lamb.
What else do you have in the room that might relate to this? Think of it as a little lamb, maybe.
A little lamb would be the Virgin Mary and the...
Mary had a little lamb.
Mary had a little lamb.
The mask, combined with the Virgin Mary figurine, gives the title of the song Jim needed to play on his xylophone, Mary Had a Little Lamb. If he'd played this song, his door would have opened.
Ah. Mary Had a Little Lamb.
It was frustrating to kind of play Mary Had a Little Lamb, the thing that got me out of my room like 2 seconds after the game ended.
He had the sheet music, and a xylophone. I mean, why would they leave a xylophone in your room if you weren't supposed to play it when we produced the sheet music?
It was slightly frustrating to hear that, you know, Steve had the sheet music from the second he opened the newspaper, you know, 15 minutes or so after he got into his room.
I'm starting to feel like the kid that nobody wants on their team because they always make their team lose. What can I say? It was, you know what, it wasn't easy. It wasn't easy. I guess I just had a bad day.
The game comes down to this moment, the final quizzes.
I want us all to win, but we can't.
This is the players' last night together. Tomorrow, they will finally find out who is the mole.
May the best player win.
Their hair.
I guess I'm dreading tomorrow a little bit, not because of whatever the outcome will be, but because I will not see my friends anymore. Would I do it again? Yeah. Would I do it differently? Probably so.
Sometimes I've loved this game and sometimes I've really hated it. I am ready to go home, I think.
We joke around about the shattered dreams and the broken hopes that lie by the wayside of all the people who've been executed. Some of those people, I or Steve or maybe even Catherine, have had a hand in shattering their hopes of making it this far. And that's just the game. Despite the kind of stupidities, intricacies, and pressures of the game, I've made some friends.
First, there were 10 strangers stranded in a California desert. Now, there are 3, Jim, Catherine, and Steven. The journey nears its end. Here in Ronda, in this old bullfighting ring, one of the oldest in Spain, the final battle is about to begin. In this ring, one of these players will win, one of them will lose, and one of them is the mole. Welcome. Congratulations. You guys have played a great game, and I hope that whatever else happens tonight, each of you feels proud about how far you've come. This is actually the last moment that all 3 of you will be together as a group. So if there's anything you want to say to each other, now is the time.
Good luck.
Good luck.
Good luck to you.
Good luck.
The game comes down to this moment, the final quizzes. Tonight, you'll be taking the quizzes simultaneously. 25 questions about the mole and how much you know about them. You guys have any questions? All right. Good luck.
One of them is the mole. I'm pretty sure that's Catherine. She's smart, intelligent, attractive. I think she's got a lot of qualities that a mole would probably have.
My theory is that Jim knows that Steve is the mole. I mean, it's the perfect strategy for the mole, teaming up and trying to focus suspicion on a third party. While I think that worked well when there were more players, they're not gonna convince me I'm the mole. I know I'm not.
I'm really starting to like Catherine a lot. I told her I have a little crush on her, weirdly enough. She's just really cool. I suspect her, but I feel a weird sense of trust in her.
Jim is a very bright guy, but we seem to be always doing something that is his strong suit. Is it coincidence that he just happens to speak French and we're in France?
I'm almost proud of what Steve and I have, assuming that he's not the mole. You can sit there and you'd be, well, maybe he's playing you, maybe he's not. At some point, you have to take the facts that you have, make a judgment, and go with it.
Do you have a safe in your room? I had a safe in my room.
Yeah, I do.
He missed lots of clues that I would hope a police officer would find. As far as investigating a murder, I'm not sure I'd put him on that.
A guy got in, ran through a window, and was apparently shot at by Catherine on a really odd trajectory to me that points fairly decisively that she missed on purpose.
The whole refusing to pose nude in the dice game, I thought that seemed odd.
I don't want to do this.
Particularly when I met his wife, and she said she would have posed nude. But he kept saying, well, I couldn't do something like that without asking my wife.
I think I'd go for this, actually.
There was big debate over whether or not to include the jewelry.
Oh, no, I'm glad you did. There was also a giveaway.
I didn't want to put the jewels down because I thought it was too much.
You refused to put two casts on, you big chicken!
How am I gonna go to the bathroom with two casts on my legs?
It's just ridiculous. I mean, who wouldn't put casts on? I can't come up with any justification that makes sense. I'm 85% sure that Steve is the mole.
If Jim is the mole, then I'll be a purple pig in a tutu. There's no way Jim is the mole.
I want us all to win, but we can't.
So here's what's going to happen next. While we tally the results of your quizzes, you'll each be sequestered separately. When we're done, you'll be brought back to the ring individually and given the results. I'll enter your name into the computer. If a green thumbprint appears after your name has been entered, you are either the winner of $510,000 or you are the mole. If a red thumbprint appears after your name has been entered, unfortunately, you are the mole's eighth and final victim. All right, Jim, please leave through there. Catherine, through that door. And Stephen, through there.
Who will win? And who is the mole? Find out tomorrow night. Tomorrow night on The Mole.
Final episode, final execution. I'm either going to be gratified or duped.
You know, I guess it's not the end, but the journey and getting there, and I had a good time.
Needless to say, I'm a little bit tense.
We'll reunite the players and show you how The Mole outwitted them all.
Jim is the mole.
Catherine's the mole.
I'm gonna have to just go with Steve.
We'll also show you some clues that would have helped you, as well as the players, figure out the mole's identity. Aha. One of these three players will win $510,000, and one will be revealed as the mole.